Hello and welcome to this weekly webinar on Bhagavad Gita and mental health, a transdiagnostic perspective. Today, it's our great pleasure that we have Dr. Jyotsna Agarwal, Associate Professor, Department of Clinical Psychology, IMHANS, Bangalore, with us to deliver a lecture on the topic. I heartily welcome you, sir, ma'am. It's a great pleasure to have you with us. We also have Director Murari Desai, National Institute of Yoga, Dr. I.V. Vasava Reddy, sir, with us. A very warm welcome, sir.
Namaste, thank you.
We also have Communication and Documentation Officer, MTNMI, Mohammad Tayyab Alam, with us. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vandana.
Now, without any further delay, let us start this webinar with prayer. ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै
Inviting even an expert of you, modern medicine and allied sciences. Today's lectures on Bhagavad Gita and mental health, a transdiagnostic perspective, is quite relevant considering the Gita Jayanti. And also in depth in nature. Today we have with us Dr. Jyotsna Agarwal, Associate Professor, Department of Clinical Psychology, National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences in IMHANS, Bangalore. On behalf of Murarji Desai, National Institute of Yoga, and my own behalf, it's my privilege to welcome you, ma'am, in this Friday's webinar session. I also extend my warm welcome to Dr. I.V. Vasava Reddy, sir, Director Murarji Desai, National Institute of Yoga. It is because of sir's untiring effort which led to the huge success of Friday's webinar on various social media platforms. I also welcome all the staff and the students of the institute and also the social media friends. Again, Merry Christmas to all of you. And thank you,
sir. Now I would like to request Director sir deliver introductory remarks. Sir.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Today's guest speaker. Respected Professor Jyotsna Agarwalji, my colleague in the institute, Sri Tayyab Alam ji, Dr. Vandana, and all the faculty members and student friends of my institute, and many thousands of people joined this webinar through various social media. My pranams to you, all of you, and hearty welcome to you on my personal behalf and on behalf of the great institute, Murarji Desai, National Institute of Yoga. It's my privilege to just introduce the today's guest speaker, Madam Jyotsna ji, and very well-known personality in the IMHANS campus. And we have a privilege to work with her in our various projects with Professor Gangadhar. And for your information, madam, last week we have Professor Gangadhar was very kind enough to speak to us, all our students. Just to inform you before I start, I may forget, today is a very auspicious day. One is it a Gita Jayanti, and it's a Krista Jayanti, and it's a Christmas. And one of the tall leader of our country, I respect him more, Adaraniya Atalji's Bharti Madan Mahalviya. And two important physicists I respect, one is Newton and Einstein. Today is Einstein birthday. So,
okay.
So many these things and my hearty best wishes. And also Merry Christmas to all my faculty and student friends. With these few words, it's my privilege to introduce today's guest speaker, Dr. Jyotsna Agarwalji, currently associate professor in the Department of Clinical Psychology at National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences, which is popularly known as NIMHANS, Bangalore. From here, she had completed her MPhil and PhD degree. She is consultant for adult psychiatry, geriatric medicine, positive psychology, and integrative medicine, integral medicine, along with being the faculty in charge of VIPRA, Vedic Indian Psychology Research and Applications, very important department, and division under which she runs two clinics, Sattva and Swasthya, for enhancing well-being informed by yogic psychology. She was awarded the prestigious Fogarty International Postdoctoral Fellowship at Washington University School of Medicine, St. Louis, USA, and another postgraduate fellowship at S. Vyasa University, Bangalore. Prior to joining NIMHANS, she served as an assistant professor at the Indian Institute of Technology, Patna. She has also worked as a research scientist at Community Empowerment Lab, Lucknow, and as a senior officer at Tata Motors Limited, Jamshedpur. Her research interests include a positive psychology, preventive and promotive approaches towards public mental health, psychotherapy, Indian psychology, and yoga and consciousness studies. She is currently working on applications of Indian psychology and positive psychology in the clinical setting. It's a very interesting combination, madam, and it's a great privilege to have you today, and hearty welcome to you.
Thank you, sir.
Just hearty welcome to you. And just before I'm inviting you, to inform you that Institute is conducting this Friday national webinar. It's not national, it's international. Many of the international students of the institution and followers also join live or after the event is over according to their time zones. And we started in the month of October with your Ayush for Immunity, Yoga for Immunity campaign. Now it has become so popular, every Friday many students and faculty are waiting for 6 to 7 slot to gather some more knowledge from the eminent speakers like you. So today, this is Bhagavad Gita and mental health. And we consider in yoga two most important texts. There are many Upanishads, Vedas, etc. One is Yoga Sutra of Patanjali and Bhagavad Gita. These are the two important texts. And these yoga is always mind-centric. And most of the people misunderstood it is for physical only, but it is mostly for everything but mind-centric. Psychological aspects are predominant in the teachings of both Gita and Yoga Sutra. So today in this talk, madam is going to give an overview of the current mental health picture in India, especially with respect to the most common mental health disorders. It will then cover some of the common psychological factors behind many of these disorders, which are also known as transdiagnostic factors. The insights from Bhagavad Gita concerning these factors will then be discussed. It will finally conclude with a deliberation on how Bhagavad Gita can contribute to positive mental health. The talk, although based on latest scientific research, will try to simplify it for the larger audience. And with these few words, Bhagavad Gita for mental health is one of the topic of our syllabus for all the courses. It may be certificate or diploma or degree, master degree. So this lectures will going to be a new light, throw new light for our students. With these few introductory remarks, once again, madam, I heartily welcome you. Once again, thank you for accepting us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So I invite you to deliver lecture. Professor Jyotsna Agarwal.
Thank you, sir. And it's a pleasure and an opportunity, great opportunity. I'll be presenting the slides, and Then we'll go further. So is it visible? Am I audible?
Yes, yes, audible and visible. Carry on, madam. Congratulations. Thank you.
So we start with the message that chemist told every time when Bhagavad Gita is studied, there is also something called Bhagavad Gita Dhyanam. I start with in that spirit, with a sense that like I know little, I will try to share that, and it's a vast where I will take probably an entire lifetime to understand a little bit of it. So my attempt is here to impart whatever I've learned so far and also to explore that along with you all. So special thanks to the director, sir, as well as his team to organizing this program. And I will probably look forward to attending other programs in future, which sir is organizing. And here I'm here to share my I start with a little bit of a background of the mental health. So it's like a wide range of conditions with variety of symptoms, like, na, for example, deep ongoing sadness, difficulty in concentration, feeling of fear, worry, etc. And all of these can also be like, na, divided into two very broad categories. One is like common, one is very severe. So, and I'll focus more on the common mental disorders. So common mental disorders are also called common cold of mental disorders, in fact, because they are so common. And it includes depression, anxiety, and on the entire spectrum of anxiety, like generalized anxiety disorder, panic, phobia, etc. The current picture in India is like, now you will see that there's huge amount of common mental disorders. It's same in the world as well as in India in one of the surveys which was done by NIMHANS. Like National Mental Health Survey, it was found that 10% of the population at any point of time are having common mental disorders, which here includes like depression, anxiety, as well as disorder. 1 in 20 people suffer from depression, 1 in 5 have addiction, and along with that, high suicidal risk, almost 1% of the population is another concern. If we put them in numbers instead of percentages, it will look huge. So why should we bother about it? Because mental health disorders are at a death rate. A lot of disability with respect to not able to function well, work, social life, family life, etc. A lot of treatment cost is also associated with that. And it is also related to a lot of physical. Then intangible cost is also there. Like, for example, poor quality of life. Can you see? Hello?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible. It is visible.
Okay. So, unfortunately, there's a lot of treatment gap present. For example, 28 to 83% of general mental disorders, and almost 86% it goes to alcohol use disorders, where people, when they have a problem, they do not have treatment for it. One reason is that there are very few mental health professionals. Like, now, if you look into it, 1.9 or around 2 mental health professionals in per 1 lakh people, as compared to 71 to 72 in high income countries. This is further complicated by people not knowing about mental illness. It's not very affordable, as well as most professionals are in the urban area, and there's a lot of gap between rural and urban. Non-specialist professional in this mental health care delivery, where we can do prevention and a lot of health promotion through yoga and Indian psychology. And Bhakti Yoga Sutra, Yoga Vashishta, etc. are full of mental health insights, which can be built into large-scale community program that can overcome the issue of culture match, low resources and low number of people who are available there, and as well as have more acceptance. This idea is further supported by a shift which is happening currently in the field of mental health. So a lot of studies, almost 2-3 decades back, started happening with newer brain, investigative techniques to study brain and all, brain genes, etc. But after a single cause for mental illness, no one-to-one cause which one can really work with.
So it's a multifactorial. So there is a consensus that mental illness is related with like genetic, family, social, psychological, and within psychological also thinking related, cognitive related, emotion related, relationship related, behavioral related processes. And therefore, there's no single cause. So it, you can say that like one cause can lead to multiple disorders and causes can lead to a single disorder. So there is like a lot of complex interactions which is happening in the field. And further, it's very interesting that although people were thinking that, okay, a person who will have one single disorder will have lifetime, they will always have the same disorder. But recently, a study which followed, not many studies which follow people over a long period of time related to mental illness. So this particular study followed children from age 11 years to the time when they became 45 years of age, adults. And they found that people moved from one disorder to another disorder. There was a decrease and increase of mental disorder within the same person also. And similar finding was also recently only published by another Dutch group, which they had studied almost 5.9 million people over 16 years. And they found that it's not that one person having one disorder will always stay with that or get better and will never have that disorder again. People keep having same disorder, different disorder again and again. It goes down, it goes up and all. And therefore, we need to look into not just by disorder perspective, but actually something which is behind many of these disorders. Those common causes are called transdiagnostic because they are beyond one single diagnosis. And this approach can actually be more efficient because especially when there are multiple disorders present, even in one person, for example, having anxiety and depression together, then this actually is much better approach. And it is possible to scale up or do a lot of community work also. To that stage level where you can have something which is at a community level, you give some kind of intervention and then gradually someone who needs more intensive treatment can go to a hospital. And this is something which we understand intuitively. So now what I will do is I will be talking more about some of the common transdiagnostic factors, those factors which might be underlying multiple disorders, many studies have shown, and Bhagavad Gita, how they are related to insights from the Bhagavad Gita. And here things become really interesting. So first thing I would talk about is affective motivation. So there are two ways, two types of motivation which move people towards something or want them to move away from something. One is approach where people want to, even young children would want to move towards something which is new, thrilling, pleasurable. And even when it can lead to a negative outcome. Further, people also want to go away from something which is unpleasant, for example, punishment, hurt, negative emotions, etc. And both these tendencies, if become dysfunctional, if becomes too high, it's associated with various types of mental health disorders from anxiety, depression, addiction, etc. Some people might be high on one of these. For example, some people may always look for approaching new things, rewarding things, interesting things, thrilling things. On the other hand, some people may always want to avoid something which is unpleasant and all. And some other people may be high on both. They want to really experience the positive and avoid the negative. And those who are from yoga philosophy or yoga psychology may recognize these things as rag and dvesh, the common affliction which is understood and often spoken about in the yogic language. If you look into Bhagavad Gita, in the first chapter itself, Arjuna is trying to avoid fighting because it is very unpleasant, aversive. He has to fight with his family members, extended family, people whom he admire or respects. He would prefer to run away from the war field and leave. And simultaneously, you will see that Krishna is telling him to keep moving, keep fighting. So if you see that people may, whether they are driven by, as I mentioned earlier, that experiencing whatever is pleasant or driven by wanting to avoid. And it can also be very general that, okay, someone is always trying to be approaching everything which just pleasant, or it can also be very specific. So someone wants to always pursue something which is like related to success, achievement, accomplishment, or someone else might be focused on more of getting pleasure. So then these mixtures can lead to a variety of things which we see in the world, like people move are pushed by or driven by love relationship or success or creative idea or thrill of risky driving. It can vary. And what one chooses can also influence their mental health. So this is connected with the idea of the Triguna in Gita. So if you see that Triguna Tita is an ideal idea state, but it is too far away. But one can still work towards increasing their sattva or choose sattvic goals. In fact, we had done some studies in our Nimhans, and we found that tamas is actually associated with alcohol dependence. So people who are diagnosed with alcohol dependence were having high level of tamas. So similarly, different kind of problems are related to different kind of combination of rajasic and tamasic, depression associated with these rajas and tamas. Therefore, type of goal, what someone chooses to pursue, as well as why they are pursuing and the way they are pursuing, influences whether they reach, whether they meet, but also how they felt afterwards. For example, if they got it, how did they felt? If they did not get it, how they feel? So, for example, Sri Aurobindo, one of the yogic mystic goal, they can achieve it, but they can afterwards feel very satiated, bored, tired, and we all would have experienced something like this. And when you do not get it, then you feel disappointed and bitter. Another study in the field which talks about linkers versus non-linkers. So when someone links the achieving of their goals with their happiness, it is called linkers. And they may achieve more, but they also have been found to be having lower well-being. The other type of group is those who do not connect their achieving something with their happiness. So they can pursue something but be okay with not getting or getting. And that connects with, if you look into it, the entire idea of Swadharma, Nishkam Karma, and the idea of Yajna in the Bhagavad Gita. So in fact, Bhagavad Gita emphasizes a lot of different shifts in oneself related to action, related to one's goal and one's work and how one pursues those goals. So increasing awareness about it, increasing how many other factors influences it, in knowing better what you exactly need to do, what is your right action to do, what is your what matches within with your inner self, what goal, as well as how do you pursue. So not being too concerned about the outcomes, the success and failure, and of acting as in the spirit of offering or sacrifice. So apart from goal pursuit, there is another transdiagnostic factor which is related to emotions. So it's related to how often you experience negative emotions, how easy or difficult you find it to manage your emotions, how easy you find it to tolerate unpleasant emotions, and how much you are guided by or driven by to avoid unpleasant emotions. So here Bhagavad Gita emphasizes development of emotional balance or samatvam. And if you see that, it repeatedly encourages that you develop the capacity to tolerate. It can be unpleasant bodily sensations, for example, shitoshna, heat and cold, as well as emotions, sukha and dukha. Here, this cartoon really brings that idea out that when your ice cream falls or melts, do you also melt? Do you also throw a tantrum and feel absolutely life is really unfair to you? Or you are okay with that? You are you can move on with that. Bhagavad Gita further gives multiple techniques which would help in managing emotions. It can relate to meditation, contemplation, pranayama, surrender or offering one's work to the higher power or the universal forces, shifting one's attitude,
developing a larger perspective about oneself and universe and the divine, and being a witness to one's body, one's mind, which is commonly known as mindfulness in today's world, but in Bhagavad Gita it is talked about as Sakshi Bhava and Kshetrajna, which the one which knows the field. Another idea is related to non-attachment and psychological flexibility, which is has been given some importance in the field, and they have found that it has like na influence with multiple mental health issues. So one is like needs to develop a healthy separation and ability to let go. So if you see that it's very common way of like catching monkeys, so that if they put it into a jar with a small mouth, a monkey would not leave something which is desirable, a food. And because it doesn't leave, his hands wouldn't come out because he's holding, he's grasping. So a lot of pain and suffering in our lives is also related to that, when we are like not able to change something, like let go, or like we are stuck with something. Another thing is related to seeing the self as the consciousness, which is called self as the context. Because in a space, a lot of things happen. In one room, a lot of things, a bed is there, a table is there, laptop is there. Same way within our consciousness, there's like the thoughts come and go, feelings come and go, impulses come and go. So knowing and seeing oneself as a consciousness, as a context, and being able to step back from our thoughts and feelings and not being like completely sucked into it is called cognitive diffusion. And this is used in therapy across diagnosis. And if you look into it, this idea is running across Bhagavad Gita in multiple chapters. This idea is there. I'll going beyond the mental health disorders, there's something more I would like to discuss is related to positive mental health, and which is one of the common thing which I would like to talk about. It's not very often spoken about, is related to awe. It's a feeling, actually a feeling which has not been given a lot of attention in past, and only in the last few years it is being studied. Awe is an overwhelming feeling of reverence, admiration, fear, and it happens when we see something grand and beautiful and powerful. It can be like a night sky with like a lot of stars, it can be rising sun, it can be a powerful like a waterfall or something. It is also related to what you say, bhakti yoga, because when you are devoted to something higher than yourself, it can make you feel a sense of awe and reverence. Interestingly, it is in many studies it has been found that awe, the sense of awe, is related to multiple. It can make people feel connected to other people, with the larger humanity. It can decrease the sense of materialism. It can make people feel more generous and cooperative. It can enhance the sense of time, as if like the time has slowed, you have enough time to do everything. It can improve health. It can improve mood. It can also improve the sense of satisfaction cognitively and critical thinking. And finally, it can also bring a sense of humility. You feel that this immensity around you and this universe is so big, and you are small, you get a perspective actually. If you look into it, Bhagavad Gita chapter 9 to 11 describes such feelings of awe, not just when Krishna shows his Vishwarupa, but also Arjuna saying that I'm afraid, please come into your softer form. And interestingly, it can actually trigger the same feeling, if not exactly same, but at least like some sense of awe for the reader also, if one can go a little deeper into these chapters. Finally, many chapters in Bhagavad Gita are devoted to positive qualities, which are worth cultivating. It can be related to persistence, it can be, which is called dhriti, it can be related to friendliness and compassion, which is like social and interpersonal emotions and attitudes. And in it is called Devi Sampada and Satvik Guna. If you look into it, especially towards the later chapters 16, 17, 18, these are further described in a lot more detail. Positive aspects of, and they have found that it is related to a lot of these positive qualities are related to basic ingredients of positive mental health. For example, it having these qualities, developing, cultivating these qualities are related to positive emotions. It helps people to have more engagement with life, with activities, give them a sense of meaning, improve their relationship, as well as give them. Also leads to success. And Bhagavad Gita keeps talking about how these are the qualities worth cultivating. You need to work and gradually keep working on it. So give a summary to that, that Bhagavad Gita is a treasure house of innumerable psychological insights. It may enhance health through many pathways, as we have seen that it can enhance health, mental health through the cultivation of positive emotions or positive qualities. It can enhance mental health through developing an equanimity and quality of seeing emotions with an equal mindedness, seeing other people with equal mindedness, seeing cultivating positive interpersonal qualities, for example, maitri, karuna, mudita, and it can also lead to some sense of tolerance of not just the usual aspects of life, but also the intensely unpleasant aspects of life, things which we would want to avoid and run away from. And therefore, I believe that time has come to increasingly build mental health interventions based on these insights, where we can use these insights in with a very current language, because a lot of times gap happens because of the gap of language, not because of the gap of insights. As Shorvindo says that Bhagavad Gita is one text where there is very little, although every text, every ancient text has something which is timeless and something which is local and more fit to that particular time period. But Bhagavad Gita actually has very little which is bound by a time and culture. It is timeless and it is it goes beyond for expanded sense of humanity, which it can help people wherever they are. And therefore, it is important that we use some of these insights to build mental health interventions and for the larger community. Thank you. I acknowledge that there have been a lot of people and forces behind which helped this making this presentation. Thank you. And I'm open to a lot of questions, comments, discussion, because I think I have spoken about some of the ideas which might be easy for some people and difficult for other people. So we can have many more questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam. It's very interesting. Vandana?
Yes, sir.
Could you just start some discussion so that we can take to the next step?
Yes, sir. So yeah. I would like a question.
You ask to madam.
How about Parkinson's syndrome? Somebody has sent this question.
Huh.
How can Gita help in Parkinson's syndrome?
Okay. So given that Parkinson's syndrome is a pretty biological aspect, or you can say syndrome, but with that comes a lot of emotional aspects. So, for example, difficulty accepting that I have a Parkinson, feeling upset about it, feeling what you say, not able to move further in life along and live a life with higher quality of life in spite of Parkinson's disease. So Bhagavad Gita can help in the emotional part of it, that what do you think about, why has it happened? Many times when people have something, illness which they has a lot of effects like this, they have the feeling that why me? Why did it happen to me? And how can it happen to me? They feel angry about it. They may feel wanting to completely not think about it, not do things which might be helpful to them. And they may even feel sad and depressed about it. So Bhagavad Gita can help them in accepting it, accepting to a level where they can tolerate it, if not having a, before reaching the full acceptance. And also be able to see that in spite of this, what can I do? How do I contribute in my life? How do I live a positive life, healthier life psychologically, in spite of these symptoms?
Ma'am, can you elaborate the word transdiagnostic a bit?
Okay, so transdiagnostics means beyond one single diagnosis. So when we talk about something, a cause behind, for example, anxiety. So we are only talking about anxiety. On the other hand, a person who is having anxiety may also have depression, or may, if not simultaneously, they may later have depression. So transdiagnostic means that something which goes beyond a single diagnosis. So for example, emotional regulation difficulty are behind anxiety also, depression also, substance abuse or addiction also. So similarly, many of the other things which I have discussed are related to or are can be underlying multiple diagnoses. It can be associated with depression, it can be associated with, for example, not able to accept emotions, not able to let go of emotions, not able to tolerate unpleasant emotions, or only wanting to have pleasantness in life can be part of many of these diagnoses, anxiety, depression, substance abuse, some of the personality disorders and all. So therefore, transdiagnostic means something which cuts across multiple diagnoses, which is behind or underlying many of them and makes people vulnerable to them. So transdiagnostic interventions have also been developed where interventions related to some of the factors which I have discussed are used for to target people who are having comorbidity, so they are having anxiety as well as depression. It can also be used to target groups where some people have anxiety, some people have depression. So it's not a very specific, very small group where people only have a one single diagnosis. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am, yes. So can we say can we say that Bhagavad Gita can help in overcoming mental disorders chanting of Bhagavad Gita?
So as I said earlier, that the idea is that we do stage level kind of interventions. So for some people who might be more vulnerable to mental illness because of these transdiagnostic factors, we can do large scale work related to using the insights from Bhagavad Gita. On the other hand, someone who has already had a disorder may benefit better with a proper consultation where a person or a professional who is already trained in modern mental health practices can help them better. So I won't be able to comment on whether chanting Bhagavad Gita will help or not, because maybe I've not really researched. I've looked into the more the psychological part, the insight part.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I wouldn't be able to
comment. Thank you, madam. Yes, only one or two questions. There are many, but always... One is, madam, whenever people misunderstood mental health with psychiatric disorders, because many of the students, seeing their questions, they don't understand between the mental health and mental problems or psychiatric disorder, psychiatry. That's one thing. But most importantly, in clinical psychology, what is the role of counseling? And in the counseling, can you able to inculcate the principles of Bhagavad Gita or Yoga Sutra, whatever it be, if the counselor knows the fundamentals of these great Indian texts, yoga texts? This is one question. The second one is, when psychiatric disorders convert into physical symptoms or physiological symptoms, so in my opinion or in many people, we need the medication is compulsion. But continuing medication only long term, it's going to affect. So that's why research are needed to how to integrate these two great sciences. One is purely on psychological, and in when you come to psychiatric medicine, and we advocates medicines which will have the impact on our body. So these are the two questions. How
Okay. So coming to the first question on the counseling. The counseling, yes. Counseling can help people having a variety of disorders, and especially it is the treatment of choice for people having common mental disorders, as I said, that common cold of mental illness, anxiety, depression, etc. A lot of studies have shown that counseling, or in fact we call it psychotherapy, so that is so effective that not only people get better, but even brain changes just by the psychotherapy or counseling. So it is quite effective, but it is what you say, very intense, like now. So people have to spend hours together week after week to work on it. On the other hand, medication can help people to start that journey. So many times when people come, when people are like now having a severe mental depression, for example, they are not in a position to engage with the counseling. They wouldn't respond to it. They wouldn't be willing to talk to a person. So that time the medication helps so that they reach a level where they are willing to engage and work with the therapist. And then the journey can start. So therefore, both of these have its place. And sometimes in combination, sometimes some illness work better with medication and some illnesses can work better with psychotherapy. In fact, sometimes people have what you say, normal reactions to abnormal conditions in life. For example, they have someone died or some trauma happened or something like that, a breakup happened and all. So that time we are not like looking for medication, but we are more looking for psychotherapy, which can help these people. But it depends from case to case. It's very important to remember that each person may need a very individualized treatment. The second question related to mental illness influencing the physical illness or like leading to physical illness. Yes, because the way that our brain and mind is and body is connected, that many of the negative emotions, when it is accumulated over time, it can actually lead to a lot of hormonal changes, and those changes can lead to physical illness. So it's not that one-to-one that, oh, you feel upset and then you get an illness, but it is a long and indirect pathway where a particular kind of emotions, a stress, the way you perceive it, can lead to a particular kind of hormones in the body. And those chemicals can actually lead to, over time, certain changes in the body, which like can, for one person it can lead to one illness, for another person can it can lead to another illness. So it will depend on also who is vulnerable to which kind of illness in situation where a person is stressed. And therefore it's important that we use a lot of insights from modern sciences as well as these ancient sciences to help people in a large-scale manner, given that we are like a big country and we have we need to have multiple approaches to target this problem.
Definitely, madam. Thank you very much, madam, for your very valuable suggestion. Because what we are thinking, we are preparing on the basis of, these are all considered as a philosophies. Indian yoga means it's a philosophy, not in work. But we developed this thing into scientific aspect, then technology then into appliances. So on that basis we developed the body alignment with some postures, breathe alignment, then detoxification. All these procedures are there. Many of the modern medical scientists or psychiatrists or something, they are not aware of these very, very innovative methods and tools available in our ancient texts. So we try our MSc students or etc. Let them make, because they study this for 5 years, 6 years, and we are asking them to do it. In the near future, that may be very new models will come and integrate. You are rightly tell that in the beginning, when a patient comes in is a very severe depression condition, and counseling or anything will not happen. Therefore, they need a medication. It's my 100% pure view. Wherever it is need a medication, and our yoga people should not be adamant. And we have to be, the patient is more important, cure is important, and we need the solution. So both side, if it is there, then it will work out. With these few words, madam, thank you very much. So there is small request for you, and one of our student today, because the whole day we have a series of lectures. There are 4 eminent scholars spoke on Gita. Now our one of the student would like to make 10 minutes presentation.
Sure.
If you permit and let him present. Either Vandana or Tayu, Satyam ko let him cut. If you permit, madam.
Yes, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, Satyam.
Satyam, shuru kare.
Yes, ma'am, I'm sharing my screen.
10 minutes or 15 minutes, ma'am.
Sure, sure.
Thank
you. Is that visible, sir?
Not yet. Try again.
Sir, I have presented the screen. Kindly confirm that.
Sir, Satyam is not visible. Have you shared the PPT with Rishi?
Sir, I have shared my screen and.
Sir, it has been shared with Rishi.
Rishi, please, you do the work from your side, please.
Yes, it's. Yes, it's coming.
Okay, namaste, namaste, sir. Namaste, ma'am. Thank you, director, sir, for giving me this great opportunity to present my slide. My topic is scientific investigation to the stress of Arjuna. I don't know how scientific I may sound, but I'm a student of yoga, and if I do any mistake in the scientific calculation, kindly forgive me. This is our dearest Lord Krishna and his friend Arjuna. So everybody today is talking about what Krishna taught Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, it may be karma yoga, it may be bhakti yoga, it may be jnana yoga, it may be sannyas, karma sannyas. A lot of teaching has been given, but I don't know, we can be a jnani or we can be a dhyani. One thing is very certain, very sure, that we can be Arjuna every day. We are Arjuna every day because we are stressed as Arjuna was. So he is Arjuna, is one of the five Pandavas, son of God Indra. So he is very having very valuable, very strong, very strong built, and he was physically and mentally very strong. Still, he got the stress. These are the some example, some informations about Arjuna. Now I would like to put some focus. Is that working, sir?
Yes, yes, you go ahead. It is working.
Okay, ma'am, thank you. I would like to draw your attention toward this word Vishad, because this word Vishad having different roots. Madhvadi, Imam Kuru Vishadam, Vishadi, Kartavi, Vratiti, Jada, Tatu, Pratimudam. So there are a lot of meanings related to this word Vishad. Dejection, sadness, depression, and disappointments, languor. So in my finding, I found that there are three words that can be closely associated with this Sanskrit word Vishada. First one is anxiety. Everyone nowadays, at least me, everybody facing the anxiety issues. And the second word I find very close conjunction with this word Vishada is stress. And the third, not very less popular, is depression. So Arjuna is stressed, Arjuna is a little bit depressed, and Arjuna is anxious also. So the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita is famous as the word Arjuna Vishada Yoga. So Vishad can be also be a yoga. This is a very miraculous thing. And I ask a lot of people, a lot of scholars, that which chapter you do like. They say, I'd like chapter 2, I like chapter 6, I like chapter 12 and all and all. Nobody says that he likes chapter 1. And luckily, Bhagavad Gita starts with the chapter 1 only. So in first chapter, Arjuna speaks about his symptoms. And that's what all about Bhagavad Gita was. Solving the problems of Arjuna, right? Solving the problems, mental turmoils, physical traumas, whatever he was facing. Bhagavad Gita is a personal talk. So that's why it's also known as Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvad, a dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna. So first one, first chapter is very, very much, much important. So I would like to talk here that stress is a physiological or psychological reaction, right? It's our response, and it is response in respect to stressors. So stress is a response. It can be biological or physiological. And stressors are the causes, right? So there is a cause and effect relationship between stressors and stress. So what was the stressor for Arjuna? He was having everything. He was having a friend who is Lord himself. But why he was stressed? He was stressed because of Drashtavemam Swajanam Krishnam Yujutsam Samupastitam. He saw facing his family members, cousins, teachers, opponents in the battlefield. So his own friends became enemy, right? Hear the word, yujutsum, that are gathered for the wish of fighting. So he say, nakangche vijayam krishnam. He is not having any desire for rajya, for anything else. He is purely conscious about his family, his relationship. So in this COVID-19 pandemic, everyone is very well familiar about the importance of their family members and all. So here then, after this, Krishna, Arjuna says to Krishna, I don't know what to do, what not to do. I can't kill my own friends, my own guru, my own relatives. So here Krishna gives him a nice counseling. That was Bhagavad Gita, all about Bhagavad Gita, distributed in 18 chapters, structured in karma, bhakti, dhyana, and sannyas, a lot of categories. So here my whole study is about, you may say study, or I'm just a small effort, symptoms as expressed by Arjuna. So, as everybody knows that Bhagavad Gita is a book written by Sage Vyasa. Sage Vyasa is also a yogi, a rishi, and a great poet. Great poet because he wrote such an amazing epic, Mahabharata, right? So, everybody should think, at least the person who is having scientific, so-called our modern scientific empirical mindset, we should think that all the symptoms that Arjuna expressed to his friend, his mentor, his clinician, his psychiatrist, whatever you call it, what was that clinically like significant? Was that scientifically significant, or it was just like a poetical construct? He said, "Sidantimam gatrani mukham chuparasa sashidive patuscha sarire me roma harsha shajar." So, is that any scientific correlation or any scientific explanation, or it's just a matter of a poetic creation? It's just an art. It's not science. So, we should definitely do a lot of research about it, and I have done very little. These two slokas, Sidantimam gatrani mukham chuparasushati vepathuscha sarire me roma harshascha jayati. Second one is, my limbs fall and my mouth is parched up. My body quivers. And you can hear, you can see it. Stand and inhale. Gandivam satate hasta takchaiva paridahyate. He was very excelled in using this Gandivastra that was given by Lord Shiva himself. Itself, expect that he could not hold that. So, nacha saknom astatum brahmachiv. So, I have studied and these are the neurophysiological explanations. Arjuna is speaking there of the symptoms typically of over aroused sympathetic nervous system, that is the stress response. And everybody nowadays, little bit stressed. It may be eustress, it may be de-stress, and whatever, but there is a degree, there is a persistency, but everyone is de-stressed at the end of the day. The reason of all these responses is the subconscious release of a stress hormone called adrenaline. So I think Bhagavad Gita, in my opinion, Bhagavad Gita is outcome of adrenaline hormone of Arjuna. Okay. So this is the, actually I have having very less time, so I want to make it very quick. This is SAM pathway. This is HPA axis, hypothalamus pituitary axis. So I would like to draw your attention here. Falling, dropping, cessation. When he says Sidantimam gatra, here could be some copy and paste, like some font error. So kindly avoid that. I would correct that. Sidantimam gatrani. When he said falling, dropping, cessation. Whenever we go to any elevator, there is a negative pressure. There is a sudden change in gravity, the value of g, m1 m2 by r square. So we feel extra value of g. That what he felt, it was just because of over stimulation of his sympathetic activities, right? Then it stimulated errant sensory information. This errant information can be perceived as a falling sensation. So I have accumulated, compiled is what can be the possible explanation of this feeling that Arjuna has, and it's very scientific. Anyone who has overstimulation of sympathetic nervous system could feel it. It's very normal. Most of the time when someone listens that his son or her son is no more, so they just fell down. They can't stand, Sidantimam gatrani, because they feel a falling, dropping sensation, because our a lot of things are related with our cochlea and our sense of balance. So, xerostomia, dry mouth, everybody nowadays, everybody, whenever we get anxious, whenever we get stress, our mouth gets dry. So, it's very normal and it's very scientific, right? Here I have given us some physiology of this. Muscarin M3 receptors stimulates this all the activities, but it can be further it leads to a salivary nuclei to the medulla. But this medullary signal may also be affected by cortisol inputs. Cortisol inputs means your thinking, resulting from stimuli such as taste, smell, anxiety, and depression. That was the case with Arjuna, our dear friend Arjuna. And everybody should be Arjuna at least. We can't be a Jnani, we can't be a Dhyani, but we must be Arjuna. That's where Bhagavad Gita begins. So, vepathuscha sarire me, body trembles. So, we also feel this whenever we go to present anything, just like I'm doing here. We feel a lot of sensation in our legs. We feel a lot of sensation in our hands. So, there are a lot of involuntary scientific, it can be explained in a very scientific and very physiological way. There could be inclusion of different areas also. I have here explained only physiology. We can include here neuro, psycho, physio, and different perspectives also. But it's a matter of research, deep research. And again, he said, Vepathuscha sarire me, he said, Romaharshascha jayate, goosebumps. Everybody feels that whenever we get fear. Even cat, dog feels that, right? Goosebumps, here different synonyms of this, gooseless, gooses. And so it's very, very simple, very scientific. And if Arjuna felt that, it's very normal. It's very scientific. It's not just a poetic art. It's not a poetic creation. Again, he said, Gandivam satrihasat. Arjuna said, hey Keshav, how would I fight? I can't even hold my Gandiva. He had excelled Gandiva. Gandiva was the one of the most strongest ammunition at that time. It could be S-400, I don't know. It could be anything that was very, very scientific, very, very advanced. But he could not hold that. Even he had mastered that before. So because he lacked neuromuscular effect. So whenever we get stuck, our neuromuscular effects get very bad. Whenever we get any accident or anything, so we can't hold our keys, we can't drive. That's why whenever we get any minor or any kind of accident, we hold there, we stay there, we spend our entire night there, we eat and food, relax, then go next day. So it's very scientific, we can understand it. I'm running out of time, that's why I'm keeping it a little fast. Then he also felt takchaiva paridahiyate. He said burning skin sensation, anxiety symptom. So anxiety leads burning sensation. It's not very common. I have not felt that. So I don't know if anyone of you have felt that. But definitely if Arjuna felt this after facing his entire 100 brothers, his gurus and his pitamaha, so it could be very normal. It's very scientific, right? Na shaknome avastam. And even he was unable to stand because our stress stimulation has a lot of impact on our big skeletal muscles, right? So our erector spinae and many big muscles of our leg has a direct impact on our stress. Whenever you see a stressed person, you see a different gait in it, right? Whenever you are confident, you are cool, you are calm, you are content, you walk differently, right? Whenever you are stressed, you walk in a very miserable way. So if Arjuna said, I can't stand, so it was not just a poetic creation, it was very scientific and logical. Now, earth, one more is there. Brahmati vacha me manaha. Arjuna was very yogic personal, right? He was very sattvic. That's why Bhagavad Gita appeared to him. Bhagavad Gita appeared to him and he was able to receive all the grace given by Lord himself. There were other four Pandavas also. They did not get that much question, that much anxiety. If they had also gone through with the same turmoil, it could be Sri Krishna Pandava Samvad. Not Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvad. It could be a group therapy, group session, rather than a Sri Krishna Arjuna personal dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna. So whenever we get stress, everybody feels that. Whenever we are stressed, we can't think in a normal way. We stretch something, we dilate something, and we skip something, right? And in second chapter, sloka number 55 and on, Krishna has clearly told the pathogenesis, I call it, I don't know I'm accurate or not, I call it pathogenesis or pathophysiology of psychological disorders. How he said, dhyayato vishyan punsa sangaste supajayate, sangat sanjayate ka. Now here, negative approaches, nimittani cha bhashyami vipritani keswa. Before the war, before entering in the Kurukshetra field, he has not this bad omens, right? Nimittani cha bhashyami. Suddenly, when he faces stressor, I have already told his family, his friends were the stressors. He is starting thinking in the negative way. So it was very natural thing, sudden urge to escape. Whenever we feel this negative approaches, we want to escape. We want to leave the place. We don't want to talk that person. And it's a kind of appraisal. Whenever we are so lucky that we have been taught Bhagavad Gita, and along with mental health, along with some general psychology, and with some with very great teachers, we have been taught. So it's we are very lucky that we can or we should do this integration integrated studies, right? So whenever we feel anything that's going against our will, against our future, against our safety, against our existence, that is against our survival, we want to fight or we want to flight. So it was, what is my conclusion, right? Arjuna is just a simple person, but more aware of it. He is sattvic, but his mind is disturbed by the rajas and also the tamas, because he could not even fight. Rajasic persons should fight, right? He could not even fight because he had also accumulated a lot of tamas also. So I worry if he has if he was having any sleeping issues. As I don't know, it is not confirmed yet, but I heard someone told me that Arjuna used to sleep very less. And in Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan Krishna says, Yukta Abhyas, Yukta Hara Viharasya, Yukta Cheshta, Yukta Swapna Avabodha. So sleeping was very necessary, that might Arjuna was not might doing that. So here I say that Krishna told a lot of things. I took here only one sloka for you. Klabhyam Masmagamaha Partha Netat Yukta Padyate Shudram Hirdya Dorbalyam. Krishna tells him to be get ready for the fight with light. So this is little twist, and what I find very, very important for yoga science students, not only yoga student, not only science student, it's an integrated study. So Krishna tells him, so what is the conclusion, what is the my outcome is, Bhagavad Gita gives an alternative to our nervous system. I mean this. Beyond fight and flight reaction, whenever we are stressed, we are human body, we have mind, we care about our survival. Whenever anything goes beyond our survival, we want to escape or we want to scrap the stresses. So either we want to fight or we want to flight. And that was also with Arjuna. It's very clearly, very scientifically can be understood, right? So before, Arjuna wanted to fight. He was very angry. How Duryodhan can do this to me, this to my wife, this to my family, this to my clan, before that. But when he faced the stressors, he wanted to flight. And Bhagavad Gita is all about light. What is light? Light is fighting with awareness, fighting with light. So beyond fight, flight, addiction, this is one of the unique contribution of the Gita. This fighting is anxious fighting, stress fighting. It's rajasic and tamasic. This fighting is karma yoga. Thank you. This was all about my slides. If I've done any mistakes, kindly let me know. Thank you, Director Sir, for giving me a great opportunity.
No, madam, just they are all students. We are promoting them, whatever they come out. I want to promote whatever the ideas, they are maybe wrong. And once you people like you and some others listen to them, they can fine-tune and guide them so that they will be oriented.
Interesting presentation. Good job, Satya. Just to add to that, what you said, yes, like now the initial description is exactly matching the anxiety symptom as described in ICD and all. He also talks a little bit later, then in this chapter one only, the description also matches the depression. So something which fits with the transdiagnostic approach. I will also add a little more when you are talking about fight and flight. Actually, there's a very interesting story. So 100 years back, this theory came up. And after almost 100 years, there was a lab in US where they looked into why only fight and flight, whether people also do something different. And they said that, well, women don't do that. They don't do all the time fight and flight. They sometimes go to their friends, talk to their friends, take care of their children and all. And then they went back and looked into the original study.